Thank you. thankful for the love of God on Jesus Christ that lifts you up. It's His love that lifts us out of sin. It's His love that gives us forgiveness. It's His love that gives us peace. It's His love that gives us joy. It's His love that gives us eternity. So I hope this morning you're thankful for the love, the great love of God. And God, in His love, also brings women into our lives. He gives us moms, and we're thankful today for all of our moms. Each of us have moms. Not all of them are perfect. Not many of us men are either, so we're thankful for the role and the place that God has placed moms and women in our lives and in our church. The various roles that they play in our church is also very, very important. So we're glad that you're here this morning. If you have not already filled out your information card that's in your bulletin, please fill that out. And then when you leave this morning, you will drop in the offering drop box at the back of the sanctuary. So glad you're here. Going to have a great time celebrating the Lord this morning. Let's pray together. Oh, Father God, we come into your presence to rejoice in the great love of God. Nothing's greater, nothing's higher than your love. And we seek to live in your love and to walk in your love. As we come into your presence today, we thank you for who you are, for your love shown to us, for the love that is shown to moms and the ladies in our lives and our church, Father. We ask that you work in them to bring glory to your name. Grow us and help us be the people that you call us to be. Thank you, Lord, for each person that is here today. Thank you for those that are listening. May your Spirit move and work in us as we seek to be obedient to you in all things. It's in the wonderful name of Christ we pray. Amen. Let's continue singing.
Thank you. I am.
Says, I choose to praise. Sometimes you have to choose to praise when things are not looking like you want to praise. We choose to praise. I'm glad you're here today. Take your sermon insert. We've been in a series of messages over the last several weeks on forgiveness. Forgiveness. How do we forgive? And we've been saying in the last couple weeks that forgiveness and restoring the fellowship after a hurt has occurred are related things, they're related issues, but they're different issues. In other words, someone can forgive someone of a wrong, and that fellowship never be restored. So forgiveness and restoring the fellowship are important issues. Our goal, always, is for the restoring of the fellowship when there's been a hurt. When there's been a hurt, God is all about fellowship. He's all about harmony. He's all about peace. And so our goal is always to restore the fellowship. But when a hurt has occurred, generally trust has been broken or trust has been damaged. Remember we said that trust is the foundation of our relationship. It is the strength of our fellowship. So when there's been a hurt or a wrong, the trust has been damaged. Sometimes it's been severely damaged. So the question is, how is the trust rebuild when there has been a hurt? And we're going to talk about the different responsibilities in rebuilding the trust, what we do in rebuilding the trust. It's very important because we've all been hurt and we all hurt other people. So what do we do in rebuilding the trust so the fellowship can be healthy, so the fellowship, the closeness can be good? Some things are my responsibility, some of the other person's responsibility, some of them are both of our responsibilities. So first of all, commit to doing your part in rebuilding trust that has been broken and trust God. Commit to doing your part. Whose responsibility is this? Well, it's my part and it's your part. It's the one who has offended and the one who is the offender. It's the offended and the offender's response to commit to doing their part in rebuilding the trust so the fellowship can be rebuilt. And it's certainly both of our parts in trusting God, because we're always to trust God. Now, one of the verses we look at several times is Romans 12, verse 18. He says, if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace. If it's possible. Well, sometimes it's not possible. Why? Because living in harmony, living in peace, living in fellowship involves not just one person, it involves two, sometimes more. It involves the offender and the offended. Sometimes one person will want peace, but the other one won't. The other person won't do their part. You're not responsible for their part. You're responsible for your part. So you must commit to doing your part to rebuild trust so the fellowship can be restored. Now last week, I think I ended on this prayer. I said I put in your outline this week because this is where it starts. This attitude that you have toward God and with God in rebuilding trust. And so I've written it on your outline. God, I'm going to trust you in this. And when there's a wrong, when there's a hurt, when there's something that's happened, I'm going to trust you in whether you're the offender or the offender. God, I'm going to trust you in this. I'm going to seek to be obedient to you in doing my part, and in so doing, whatever happens, whatever they do, whatever they don't do, I'm going to be obedient to you. I'm trusting you. I'm in your care. I'm in your hand. I'm in your will, and I'm in your blessing. Amen? That's what should be our attitude. It's committing to doing our part, regardless of what the other person does, and entrusting God with it. Trusting with what he will do with it. So that's the first thing. Commit to doing your part in rebuilding the trust, and trust God. Then secondly, I must cover the situation and those involved in prayer. That's obvious, isn't it? We want God in the thing. When there's been a hurt, when there's been a wrong, when a fellowship has been messed up, we need God in the situation, and prayer brings God into the situation, and we must cover everything, everyone involved with prayer. Romans 12, verse 12 says, be joyful in hope. That's really important. Be joyful in hope. Be patient in affliction. We're going to talk about that in just a moment. And it says, be faithful in prayer. You see, being faithful in prayer brings God into the thing. It brings, helps me get the mind of God, and that allows me to be joyful in hope. Because if God is not in the thing, there's no hope for reconciliation. If God's not in the thing. So when we're fervent in prayer, covering everything in the situation in prayer, it gives us joy in our hope that God's working about this and we're trusting him. So cover the thing in prayer. And then number three, on the inside of your mind, this is very important, be humble. Be humble in dealing with the other person. If you are seeking to rebuild trust in a relationship where the trust has been broken, there must be humility. Who must be humble? Whose responsibility is it to be humble when trust has been broken, when there's a wrong that's occurred? Both the offender and the offended. And you may think, well, it's the one who did the offending, the one who did the wrong. They need to be humble. They need to come begging on their knees and be humble before me, you know, before I'll ever forgive them. Well, no, it's both people's responsibility to be humble. So let's talk about it. First, it's the offender's responsibility to be humble. How is the offender to be humble? Well, first of all, the offender, the one that has done wrong, the one that has been primarily the one who's broken the trust, is not to try to justify what they did or to blame somebody else for what they did. You notice we tend to do that. We tend to try to justify what we did, the wrong that we did. Sometimes we try to blame somebody else for what we obviously did wrong. And when we are doing that, we're not being humble, and we're putting a roadblock in the path of rebuilding trust and rebuilding the fellowship. So I'm to be humble. I'm not to justify or to blame somebody else, but I'm to acknowledge and humbly confess my fault in the wrong that was done. Humbly confess. And when I humbly confess, it's just something about being humble that takes the wind out of the person we wrong, takes the wind out of them wanting to strike back when we humbly confess our wrong. Also, the offender is to be humble in speaking the truth. He is to speak the truth in what he has done. He's not to speak half-truth, or he's not to try to hide the truth, but he is to speak the truth. And when we speak the truth, truth does an amazing thing. It tends to help healing. It helps rebuilding of the trust. Look at Proverbs 28, verse 13. It says, whoever conceals their sins does not prosper, but the one who confesses and renounces them finds mercy. The one who confesses and renounces them, I'll have that in a mouth moment, they will find mercy. So it's being humble and speaking the truth helps rebuild the trust. Then how about this passage? Proverbs 24, 23. An honest answer is like a kiss on the lips. That's pretty classic. An honest answer is like a kiss on the lips. It's talking about rebuilding trust and rebuilding the fellowship or the intimacy or the closeness of a relationship. Since when you're honest, it's like a kiss. And that's getting pretty close, isn't it? It helps us get closer together. So be honest. Listen, if I speak half-truth, or if I tell the one that I violated the trust with something, and they later find out that it's not the truth, or it's just a part of the truth, or if I told just a part of the truth to try to make myself look better, when they find out the truth, it'll be like they were hurt all over again. Feel like they went back to square one. You're trying to rebuild the trust. And the way you rebuild the trust is speaking the truth. Remember, he said a couple weeks ago that God works in the realm of light. Light is truth and reality. God works in truth and reality. He doesn't pretend, he doesn't see, he don't work in God. He works in truth and reality. And when we work in truth and reality, it opens the way for trust to be built. So, the offender must humble himself. Now, the offended must also humble themselves if the goal is to rebuild trust and rebuild the fellowship where it was broken. The one who was offended, the one who was wrong, you say, well, that seems strange. How is the one that was wrong? How are they to be humble? Well, first of all, if you are wrong and somebody comes to you and ask forgiveness or confesses or admits their wrong, you're to humbly accept their apology. You're to humbly accept their apology. If you don't humbly accept their apology, there's not a whole lot of hope for the trust to be rebuilt in the relationship or the fellowship to be rebuilt. You must humbly accept their apology. Also, if you're the one who is offended, you must be aware that there's a tendency to be self-righteous when you have been offended. We all have this fallen, sinful nature. And when someone has wronged me, I have a tendency to become a little bit self-righteous and say, how dare you? How dare you do that? Or have you ever heard somebody say, I wouldn't dare treat you like you treated me? See, that's been a little self-righteous. True, you may not treat them like they treated you. Maybe you treat them worse, you know? And when we withhold forgiveness or act in pride or self-righteousness, that's pretty bad, pretty wrong. Pride is at the heart of wrongs and many wrongs. We're to humble ourselves and not be self-righteous and thinking, oh, I'd never do that. Yes, we've all been hurt, and we've all hurt others. Now, it's true, you may not do the specific thing that somebody hurt you, but I guarantee you, you've wronged others, and you've hurt other people. So, let's look at a couple of verses. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 12. Why this is so important. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 12. The scripture says, so, if you think you're standing, if you think you haven't hurt anybody else, if you think that you're righteous and they're the ones who's doing wrong, be careful that you don't fall. Because we all fall in many ways. We all hurt others. You may not be the one that did the hurting in this situation, but you need to realize you need to be humble. Because you've hurt others. Maybe some things you've done also. And in the next verse, John 8, verse 7, John 8, verse 7 is probably, I started to say the most, but I'm just going to put it in the top 10. Probably one of the top 10 most misinterpreted and misapplied scriptures in all the Bible. John 8, 10, 8, 7. One of the most misapplied, misinterpreted scriptures in all the Bible. What is it? John 8, 7. Let any one of you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her. Any situation here? This woman has been caught in adultery. She is brought before Jesus by some of the religious leaders, some of the self-righteous religious leaders. She's thrown before them, and they're just using her to trap Jesus because they've been seeing that Jesus is gaining popularity and authority with the people that he speaks truth, and they want to use this one who's obviously been caught in a sin and a law to entrap Jesus and show him maybe as a false teacher or something along that would go against the law. But yet wouldn't show you. So they want to try and they throw her before Jesus and say, Jesus, what do you say ought to be done to her? The law says this. What do you say? And Jesus says, let he who is without sin among you cast the first stone. The way this is commonly used is, you should not judge anybody. You should never call something sin. You should never never say that sin or that wrong. This is right. You're living wrong, so now that's wrong. Be living in wrong. And people say this, the only perfect people should say that they're sin or they're wrong. Well, there's not a whole lot of perfect people around. That's not the point of what Jesus was saying here. He was not saying that you should not confront sin. He's not even saying that you should not judge and pronounce what is right and what is wrong. And I will know you can't say anything's right or anything's wrong because I say you're a hypocrite or bigot or whatever. But that's not what Jesus is saying. Jesus is saying, yes, we are to confront wrong, but how we do it is critical. We must be humble. These self-righteous people that were bringing this woman who was caught in a sin and throwing her before the feet of Jesus, they cared not a lick about her or anything else. Only thing they want to do is look good in front of all the people. And Jesus said, look, do you have any sin in you? And then he just dropped his stone and walked away. How are we to be humble when we have been wrong? Well, it has to do with how we receive the confession of those who wronged us, but realize also we have this tendency to be self-righteous and say, how dare you harm me like that? I wouldn't do something like this. Another way we're to be humble involves examining ourselves. That's what Jesus in John 8:7 was trying to get the people to do. Examine themselves and see if there's anything wrong in their life. Or in the case when there's been a hurt, so that trust has been broken in a fellowship, I am to look at myself, even when I'm the one that's been offended, and I'm to ask myself, is there anything or any part that I play in the breaking of this fellowship? Any part that I play in the wrong that was done? You say, any part that I played? They were the one that wronged me. What part could I play? Let me just give you an example. Let's say that you and I are having a discussion on a hot issue in society today. I mean, you can pick any number of things. But let's say we're having a discussion about a hot issue. We're discussing, we're going back and forth, and all of a sudden, you haul off and punch me in the face. Can't believe it. Can't believe you do something like that. And then things settle down a little bit, and you come and you apologize for punching me in the face. Well, I want to be humble and seeking to rebuild the trust and restore the fellowship, and I'm to look and say, did I have any part in this? Not justifying what they did in the wrong that they punched me in the face, but did I have any part in making this situation worse? Did I have any part that made it more difficult for them to resist the temptation to do wrong? Did I have any part in making it harder for them to do right? Could it have had anything to do with me calling them into discussion stupid? Could it have had anything to do in discussing me questioning their heritage or anything? See, did I have a part, not in necessarily the wrong itself, but encouraging it or making it more difficult for them to do the right? See, that humbled me when I honestly look at myself. Because, listen to this, I don't be taken wrong here, but when a wrong has occurred, seldom, if ever, is one party 100% responsible for doing everything wrong. When a fellowship has been broken, whether it's a marriage relationship, a church relationship, a friendship, whatever, when there's been a hurt or wrong, seldom, if ever, is one person 100% at fault. That's why I would be humble. If our goal is seeking to rebuild the trust, I must be humble, and I must look at myself and say, what part, in what way, did I have in this that occurred? That will make me humble. Why is humility so important? Why is it so key? Well, look at the next verse on your outline. 1 Peter 5:5. All of you, who does that include? All of you clothe yourselves with humility toward one another because God opposes the proud, but he shows favor to the humble. God will oppose the arrogant, the self-righteous, and the proud, but he shows favor to the humble. Do you need favor? You need the favor of God on your relationship. Do you need the favor of God in your marriages? Do you need the favor of God in your church relationship? Do you need the favor of God in your friendship? Then be humble. You want God's favor. And then look at this verse, Proverbs 18, verse 12. Before a downfall, the heart is proud, but humility comes before honor. Another translation says that pride causes a fall, but humility lifts us up. God lifts us up when there's humility. When you're prideful or not humble, whether you're the offender or the offended, when a problem has occurred, when you're prideful and not humble, it will hinder the trust being rebuilt and the fellowship being restored. So humility, humility is so important. And then number four, if you're seeking to rebuild the trust, you must forgive. You must forgive. And we've talked about this a lot already. Our foundational passage in Ephesians chapter 4, 25, verse 32 speaks to this, and it ends in Ephesians 4, verse 32, which says, be kind and compassionate, forgiving one another, just as in Christ, God, Christ, has forgiven you. Forgive one another. Listen, there will not be restoring of trust without forgiveness. Remember we said forgiveness and restoring the fellowship are related to different issues, but there cannot be a restoring of trust and a restoring of the fellowship that has been damaged if there's not forgiveness. Now, we can forgive and the fellowship still not be restored, but certainly, if there's no forgiveness, there's no hope of the fellowship being restored. So, fellowship, put it there. And then number five, do what is right, even if you don't feel like it. You must do what is right, even if you don't feel like it. Now, who does that apply to? Does that apply to the offended or the offender? Applies to both. The offended person is to do what is right, even if they don't feel like it. And the one who, or the offender is to do what's right. A lot of times you don't feel like doing what is right. For example, if you have been hurt by somebody, deeply hurt, do you feel like forgiving? Generally not. You may feel like punching them out. You may feel like taking revenge. You may feel like getting even. But the Bible says, I am to do what is right, even if I don't feel like it. I'm not to take revenge. I am to forgive. I'm to do what's right. And what if you are the one that did wrong? What are you to do, even if you don't feel like it? You do what's right. You're to go and you're to confess. You're to humbly acknowledge what you did was wrong. And generally, we don't feel like doing that. You ever wrong somebody, you feel like going and talking to them. You may be embarrassed. You may be shy. You may be overwhelmed with grief or sorrow. Any number of things go against you feeling like doing what is right. But whether we are the offender or the offended, we must do what's right, not just what feels right. Because so many times we want to live life based on our feelings. The Bible says the righteous live by faith, right? The righteous live by faith. What is faith? Faith is an assurance or a behavior that is based on truth. It's not just doing whatever and, you know, presuming upon God, the devil, God, or whatever, but it's living on the basis of truth. So the righteous live by the truth, not by feelings. We live by faith, not by feelings. And so we act on truth, whether we feel like it or not. So many times we want the feelings to be there so we can act, but instead the Bible says we're to act, we're acting truth, rather than the waiting for the feeling. So we commit ourselves to doing what is right, not just saying, well, I don't feel like it. Well, I don't feel like forgiving. Well, I don't feel like being humble. I don't feel like confessing. We are people of truth, living on the basis of truth, not feeling. And then number six, and this is so important, be patient and allow for the necessary time for the trust to be rebuilt. I must be patient and allow for the necessary time for trust to be rebuilt. The Bible says in Romans 12:12, we read it a moment ago, to be patient in affliction. And when there's been a wrong, that certainly is an affliction. It's a time of tribulation when someone hurts you or wrongs you. And it says we're to be patient in affliction. And whose responsibility is it to be patient in restoring and rebuilding trust? Well, it's both the offender and the offended's responsibility in rebuilding trust and patience, because, and I put this on your outline, trust takes time to rebuild. deal. Have you ever noticed that? With you, if you've been hurt by someone, it takes time to rebuild that trust, doesn't it? But many times, we are very impatient, and we may have hurt somebody, and we expect them to just immediately retrust us. We expect the relationship to be close, just like that, because we said we were sorry or something. And typically, men tend to have a little more of a tendency to expect trust to be rebuilt faster. We never say, get over it, man. Get over it, or whatever. And we just expect the trust to be rebuilt like that. But trust takes time to be rebuilt. And when there's been a hurt, we must allow the one that we have hurt the timeline for the trust to be rebuilt. Now, let me give one warning. Sometimes, when you have been hurt, and you see that the person is being very deliberate in trying to rebuild the trust, and they may be doing things to help rebuild the trust and to show that they can be trusted, like we're going to talk about in just a moment, they may be doing things, you may act like it's taking longer to build the trust than it really should take. Sometimes I like it's taking longer to rebuild that trust because we like that they're giving us so much attention. So they're making effort to do all these things we like. So just be careful. There is a tendency to pretend that it's taking us longer to rebuild the trust than it really does. But the point here I want you to see is that it takes time to rebuild trust. And so whether we're the offender or the offended, we must realize that we must be patient and not demand that the trust be rebuilled on our time. It takes time. And then on the back of the outline, very important. If you're going to rebuild trust, if you're seeking, your goal is to rebuild the fellowship of something that's been violated, the trust has been broken, you must repent and together agree on behavior that must change. You must repent. And together, this is so important. You must repent. Let's talk about repentance. A couple of verses. Matthew 3:8. Produce fruit in keeping with the repentance. Produce fruit. What's fruit? Well, it's visible things. It's things that are deeds, things that we do. So it says do visible things that are in keeping with repentance. Don't just say, well, I repent, I'm sorry. But they must be visible things that show that truly you have changed, you have repented. Or how about Acts 26:20? First to those in Damascus, then to those in Jerusalem, and all Judea and to the Gentiles, I preach that they should repent and turn to God and demonstrate their repentance. How? By just saying it? No. By their deeds. Now, this is strictly talking about relationship with God, but I want you to understand what repentance means and how it's important in the fellowship and rebuilding trust. That in regards to rebuilding trust, believing or seeing is believing. In regards to rebuilding trust in relationships that the trust has been broken, seeing is believing. Very important. People say, well, I told them I was sorry. Well, I told them I was repenting. But it ought to seeing a change. When the trust has been violated, has been broken, when a person has been hurt, they must see that there's repentance. Not just words, not just something someone say, but they must see the fruit of repentance. That there's actually a change taking place. And it takes time to reveal the trust, even when there's change taking place. Say, how much change? Well, it depends. It depends on the hurt. Depends on how many times the hurt has occurred over and over again. It depends on the degree of the hurt. It depends on the communication between the people through the rebuilding of the trust and how much change is being seen and taking place. But there has to be things that are seen that are changed. And what I want you to see here also that I put repent and together agree between the two on things that need change. If there's been a violation of trust in a friendship or relationship or marriage or whatever, then there needs to be a communication, but together, one party says, we know for me to trust, this really needs to change. And some of those things may be uncomfortable, like there may need to be a greater openness in the relationship about things that are being done, where you are, where you're not, where you'll go, where you won't go. Maybe a need to be an openness together, understanding that phone records are available, that computer access is allowed. You know, oh, okay, that doesn't seem fair. It's not fair if you are the other person either. So you're seeking to rebuild trust. And there's repentance. If there's repentance, there's a change of behavior, and there has to be evidence, has to be deeds or fruit of repentance so the person can see and trust that a change is actually taking place. And if you violate trust, it needs to be evidence so the person can trust again. We're talking about rebuilding trust. It's a hard thing. It's a pain. Remember we said last week, not easy, but it's worth it. And God calls us to be people of fellowship upon it. So God rebuilding trust, to repentance, and together. See, when you together do something in communication, whether it's friends or a couple, when you do it together and agree, that in itself tends to rebuild trust because you're working together. But then if you together agree on something and then you don't keep your end on it, that violates the trust and further breaks down the fellowship. Why? So, begin and together agree on what needs to be changed for the purpose of, not for the purpose of getting even, not for the purpose of hurting or harming, not for no purpose, but for the purpose of rebuilding the fellowship. And then the last thing, actively demonstrate love. If you want to rebuild a fellowship between two people, when there's been a hurt or the trust has been broken, you want to rebuild the trust, you must actively demonstrate love. Now, what is love? Love is not a feeling. When we say we do what's right with regards to the feeling, love is not primarily a feeling. It is a decision to act in a certain way. And in 1 Corinthians 13 is the most thorough description of how biblical love acts. How it acts, not how it feels, how it acts, and how trust is built through it. Notice that 1 Corinthians 13, verse 4, love is patient. We all talk about that, didn't we? Love is kind. It is not envy. It is not, does not boast, does not pride. Remember, it says you need to be humble. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of the wrong. Love does not delight in the evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. It talks about actively demonstrating love. Now, how do you do that? Well, I didn't put this in the outline, but you can use some things that are actively demonstrations of love and help rebuild trust. Number one, you verbalize and demonstrate sincere forgiveness. You verbalize and demonstrate sincere forgiveness. If somebody comes to you and they ask for your forgiveness, you verbalize, and you may have to do it several times, you verbalize that you have forgiven them. And then you demonstrate it by the way you're relating to them. You may not feel like it, but you verbalize that you forgive them. We're commanded to forgive. You see, if a person has wronged you, they may wonder where they stand in the relationship with you. If they're in doubt where they stand in the relationship with you, it will be harder for them to humble themselves and to be patient and hope for the rebuilding of the trust. But if they know that you have forgiven them, that will help them be patient and joyful in the hope of the relationship being restored. So you must verbalize your forgiveness to the person that's being loving, that demonstrates loving. Another thing you must do to demonstrate love is that you must verbally confirm your love for them. You know, if somebody's wronged you, you may not feel loving, but if you're in a relationship, you're still going to love them, even though they've wronged you. So you verbalize your love for them. Your love for another person is not based on what they do or they don't do, right? The Bible says, love your enemies. So your love for them is based upon you, your commitment to God. So you verbalize your forgiveness if you're the one that was wrong. You verbalize your love for them regardless of who you are. And then number three, you sacrifice openly for the other. If you're seeking to rebuild trust and restore the fellowship, you sacrifice openly for the other person. You know, a passage in describing love says, love is not self-seeking. We when you sacrifice for someone, you lay aside what you would want. You lay aside your preference. You lay aside what is easiest and most enjoyable for you, and you do for that other person that you're showing love to what they would want, what they would prefer, what they would love. Most of us do this, you know, when we were dating or when we were first married. You know, it comes up, time to go out to eat, and you say, well, honey, where do you want to go? Well, darling, is that not it? Maybe where do you want to go? Well, I don't care, sweetheart, just wherever you want to go. I want to do what you want to do. You know, there's this oozing, oozing of sacrificial love. Or, what would you like to do tonight? Well, it doesn't matter to me. Whatever you want to do. What you want to do is important. You know, just go on and on about this sacrificial love, seeking the best for others. Listen, when a person lays aside their preference for the other person's well-being, that builds trust. Right? When someone you see that they're concerned about you, they're not just concerned about themselves, that helps build with trust. So, and when trust has been broken, it's more important than ever. It's always important, but that you demonstrate love by sacrificing for that other person. And if your goal is to restore the fellowship, it's not easy to say wait for fulfill, because you're doing what God calls you to love. So I sacrifice. Now what you see as we wrap up an example how the Apostle Paul demonstrated love and encouraged the Church of Corinth to be loving in 2 Corinthians 2, verse 6 and 8. 2 Corinthians is so important, it's kind of summarizes everything we've been saying. 2 Corinthians 2, verse 6 and 8. Apostle Paul said, the punishment inflicted on him by the majority is sufficient. Now instead, you ought to forgive and comfort him so that he will not be overwhelmed by excessive sorrow. I urge you, therefore, to reaffirm your love for him. That's what we've been saying, reaffirm your love. If you're interested in restoring the fellowship, which should be, God's about harmony, God's about unity, God's about peace. If you're interested in restoring the harmony, you should reaffirm your love. See, this is the situation. We're not telling all the details. But apparently, somebody in the Corinthian church had wronged the Apostle Paul. I mean, this is kind of a little thing. It was a big thing, and it was public knowledge. It was a major hurt, a major wrong. And the church was involved in it because it involved several people, and they had brought what we would call several disciplinary actions upon this wrongdoer. He had confessed, he repented. The Apostle Paul had accepted all of that, and he had humbly responded back to the person. And the Apostle Paul said, look, this guy has suffered enough. He's repented. He's turned back. I've forgiven him. Don't keep thinking you need to make him suffer more for the wrong he did. The goal is not to make him suffer more. The goal is restoring the fellowship, and he's already supposed to do that, and yet you keep it on wanting to hurt him. Have you ever noticed how some people want to keep kicking a person when they're down? They want to extend the hurt and the pain and suffering of the other person because they caused the hurt and pain and suffering. But no, that's not the goal. The goal is to restore the fellowship. Paul says, enough. Instead of continuing to punish him more, we need to be affirming our love for him more. We need to be affirming and encourage him more and more so that he won't be overwhelmed and discouraged and say, no hope then, I give up. He needs to act in love as God loves us. See, as people of the truth, because I am a child of God, you know, I belong to him, he has placed me, we're to act in love. That's when I have a relationship to God, I have a relationship to others. When we're being wronged, when we've wronged others, we're to live in love. Did you bow your head this morning? Do you know Jesus Christ is your Savior? Have you been forgiven? Have you received his forgiveness that he provided to you on the cross? Receive his love, receive his forgiveness, and he will transform you. Are there relationships when you've hurt, when you've hurt, been hurt? With the act under the authority and the power of God, seeking to be used of God and restore that which has been broken. Father God, I thank you that you're merciful with us, that you're gracious to us, for we have wronged you and sinned you in many ways and many times, that your forgiveness and mercy is great. May you live and relate to others as you relate to us. In the wonderful name of Christ, we pray. Amen. We stand to sing our song of commitment as we relate to you. Dealing, believing us, and